The question that Bob, you and I have is this one. What are you all doing here? How good it is to be in God's house. How good it is to gather again for worship. How great it is to have the opportunity to celebrate His love to us and share that love one with another. We're so thankful that you're here with us. We're so thankful that you've been so patient. We're so thankful that you're wearing your mask. We're so thankful that you're going to do things a little differently, but yet celebrate the great thing that remains the same. The love, the mercy, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. We celebrate that today in worship. We're going to explain how we're going to receive communion when we get to that point in the service. As we talked about in the video, it's going to be in a continuous line of passion, and you'll be directed by the ushers how to do that, but I'll explain it right before we receive the Eucharist this morning. Let's turn to our bulletin and have our opening hymn as we stand and sing.
Yeah.
by his authority, I forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Create in me a clean heart, O God,
and renew a right spirit within me.
Cast me not away from your presence,
and take not your Holy Spirit from me.
Restore to me the joy of your salvation,
and uphold me with the Holy Spirit. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever will be forever. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, your Son willingly endured the evil of sin and death at the cross for our redemption. Grant to us the goodness of our Savior, so that we are not overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated for the reading.
The Old Testament reading for the 13th Sunday after Pentecost is found in Jeremiah chapter 15, verses 15 through 21. O Lord, you know, remember me and visit me, and take vengeance for me on my persecutors, and your forbearance take me not away. Know that for your sake I bear reproach. Your words were found, and I ate them. And your words became to me a joy and a delight of my heart. For I am called by your name, O Lord, God of hosts. I did not sit in the company of revelers, nor did I rejoice. I sat alone because your hand was upon me, for you had filled me with indignation. Why is my pain unceasing, my wound incurable, refusing to be healed? Will you be to me like a deceitful brook, like waters that fail? Therefore, thus says the Lord, if you return, I will restore you, and you shall stand before me. If you utter what is precious, and not what is worthless, you shall be as my mouth. They shall turn to you, but you shall not turn to them. And I will make you to this people a fortified wall of bronze, and they will fight against you, but they shall not prevail over you. For I am with you to save you and deliver you, declares the Lord. I will deliver you out of the hand of the wicked and redeem you from the grasp of the ruthless. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle is found in the book of Romans, chapter 12, verses 9 through 21. Let love be genuine. Abhor what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with brotherly affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not be slothful in zeal. Be fervent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in tribulation. Be constant in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints and seek to show hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Never be conceited. Repay no one evil for evil, but give thought to do what is honorable in the sight of all. If possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. To the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. For by so doing, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Stand, we'll be up. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 16th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
From that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and the chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, Far be it from you, Lord, this shall never happen to you. But he turned and said to Peter, Get behind me, Satan, you are a hindrance to me, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man. Then Jesus told his disciples, If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his life? Or what shall a man give in return for his life? For the Son of Man is going to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay each person according to what he has done. Truly, I say to you, there are some standing here who will not taste death until they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated. Go ahead. Look at this. Look at this. I have a sheet of paper. Do you see some stuff? on the paper. I don't like those marks on the paper. What happened here? Did somebody draw on my paper before I got to take any notes? Well, now what should I do? I only have one sheet, just one sheet in my notebook here. Well, how do I get rid of these lines? What should I do to do that? Should I shake it? Let's try it, right? Nope, it's still here. The marks are still on the paper. Well, maybe if I run back and forth. Nope, they're still here. What should I do to get these marks off of this paper? Erase it. Well, look what I have. A pencil and an eraser. Let's see if that works. Yay! It works. It happens just like that. And see, that's one of the things that we remember about the readings this morning, is that we may want to think we know how to get rid of sin in our life, but only Jesus does. So often in our lives, we do our best to get rid of those things that make us feel bad, those things that we suffer with as God's children. And our gospel reading this morning gives us a little taste of that. We hear Jesus describing what it means to be the Christ. From that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders, the chief priests, the scribes, be killed, and on the third day be raised. How do those words make you feel? They make you feel good. They make you feel happy. They make you feel worthwhile. They make you feel like, yes, that's a great solution. No, not really, right? Because what these words say is that Jesus has to do something horrific in order for us to remain as his children, to be his children, to enjoy the blessings of being his children. And what's so unique about this passage, if you can remember to last Sunday, is that when Jesus asked the question, who are people saying that I am? And disciples were giving all kinds of examples. Who was the disciple that said to Jesus who he really is? Peter, right? And Jesus then says on these words, I will build the church. And Jesus is the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And now we have Peter speaking again. And what does Peter say? Far be it from you, Lord. This shall never happen to you. It's not the way things are supposed to go. It's not the way Christ, the Messiah, is supposed to come. You're going to do some more miracles. You're going to wave your hands. You're going to say a word, and we're going to be a great people again. And that's how it's going to happen. You're going to come in, maybe with some army that you have secretly put away someplace, and you're going to take over the Romans, and Israel will be a magnificent nation again. But this way, Jesus, with you suffering, with you being handed over to the elders and the scribes, with you being killed, no, Jesus, it can't work like that. And what does Jesus say to Peter then? Does he say, Peter? I think you just misunderstood. I think you just got it wrong a little bit. I think you didn't understand what it means to be the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus gets very direct and concise. Get behind me, Satan. You are a hindrance to me, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of men. Do we do that? I think so. And I can recall so many times that I've done it over this past week and over these few weeks. I can say this. About 4 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, I was on my way to church to get some things done in preparation for our videotaping of the service and seeing how people were doing and of course some work for the district like I do in other stuff. But it was one of those mornings, and I think we've all had it, where one thing after the other kind of goes wrong, where things don't seem to fall into place, where expectations are shattered, and where it seems to be one stumbling block after another. And it was that kind of morning. And I got here about 8:15 or so, and sitting on the steps of church, there's a man. And I don't know what he's doing, but he's fumbling with something. And so I get out of the car and say, "Hi, can I help you? What's going on?" And he says, "I'm just fixing my zipper." To which I said, "Here? On the steps of the church? I mean, you have to go all the way across the parking lot to do it right here." And he said, "Yeah." And it was one of those moments in time in which I just let it out and said, "Unbelievable." And so I gather my bags and I go inside and I'm wanting to see what this guy is still doing. So I stood by the door to watch. And he fooled around with the zipper a little bit. But then he saw that we had some bags outside with some debris in there and started to look around and see what was going on. And as he was looking around, he looked up and saw me. And he motioned for me to come back outside. And so I did. And I said, "Yes." And he said, "You have a pastor here?" And I said, "Yes." He said, "Now, when you turned around, did you say unbelievable?" And I said, "Yes." To which he said, "Well, why did you say that?" And I said, "What business of it is yours?" Why, I said. He said, "Then you're not a real pastor. Real pastors don't act that way or say things like that. Matter of fact, I'm going to call your boss to let him know that you're not a real pastor." And he left. And I let him leave. I didn't go after him. I didn't try to explain. I didn't try to make an excuse. I didn't try to see what he really needed. I said goodbye and good riddance. How does that attitude, how does that demonstration fit in with this text? You have in mind the things of man and not the things of God. And it happens to us like that. We can be in a moment with a family member or a friend. We can be out trying to shop at a social distance, making sure we're going down the right aisle in the supermarket. It can hit us just like that, and we respond and react in a way in which we say, "Never will it be like this for you, Lord." That suffering, that dying, and that rising again. You see, our Savior says to Peter, as he says to us, in order for us to follow Jesus, what are we called to do? Take up our cross and follow him. Now, we wear crosses. We have crosses. But at Jesus' time, what did that cross mean? Horrific death. Suffering by suffocation many times. A horrible, tragic death. That's what it is to follow Jesus. And he takes us. At first, we say no. We want the glory, the good stuff. We want to celebrate the fact that we are free and can do what we want when we want to do it. But that's not what Jesus says is being a follower of Christ. It means say, "I'm sorry that I offended you with my words of saying unbelievable. I'm sorry that I acted inappropriately, not only as a pastor, but as a human being and a child of God. Obviously, you have something going on in your life. Something going on that maybe the church can help you. How can we do that for you today? That's something that I regret I didn't do. That's something that I've gone to Christ to confess and to receive his forgiveness." And it is one of the little things in life that I have not done as I should do. And I bask in the knowledge and faith that God's mercy and forgiveness abounds forever. And to recognize that, yes, our days we have to suffer sometimes, and that suffering can be a little thing or heavy things. And we know people that suffer with a great deal. Our nation is suffering with its view and outlook on race and culture. Our world is suffering with hurricanes and other avenues of disaster that strike and leave devastation that takes a while to fix and make right again. Our lives are suffering. We're still in a pandemic. And as thankful as we are that we can gather here today, it's not like it was in the early part of March or the latter part of February. There's family members we can't see. There's people that we can't make contact with. There are things that we can't do like we used to do. And as we give thanks to God for those moments in which there are pieces and places filled with joy, so often from our human perspective, we focus on what isn't, what we can't, what we're not able to do. And then it's placed in perspective, right? When the children of God hear his word and come to him, it's placed in perspective that the suffering that we would have to do if this Jesus did not have himself handed over to the elders, chief priests, scribes, be killed, and rise on the third day, the suffering that we experience now is nothing compared to what it would be if the Savior wasn't steadfast in his desire to save. And that's what he has done. He has saved you and me. And he has said to us, our sins are forgiven. He will say to us, come to his table and receive his body and blood. The very gift of life and salvation that reminds us of what actually takes place here. The forgiveness of our sins, the strengthening of our faith, that promise of everlasting life. How great that is as a church, that we celebrate it, that we live it, and that we live it not only with our voices, but with our lives. Suffering for Christ, serving others, seeing the needs of others above our own, so that others will see this light of the world and rejoice in his mercy that endures forever. May his joy remain our joy, today and always. Amen. And the very peace of God, which surpasses understanding, guard our hearts and minds in Christ our Savior and our Lord. Amen. Let's make confession of our faith through the words of the Nicene Creed. Please stand. I believe in one God.
Thank you.
Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. For all disciples of Jesus Christ, both here in our Savior Fairlawn and throughout the world, that we not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Let us pray for the Lord.
Bless us, Jesus, and all
of you. For the fulfillment of the Great Commission, that wherever the good news of salvation in Christ is proclaimed, hearts turn to the Lord and live. Let us pray to the Lord.
Bless us, Jesus, and all of
you. For all servant leaders in the church and in the world, that their work for our blessing show forth the goodness of Christ to the world, he died and saved. Let us pray to the Lord.
Bless us, Jesus, as we serve you.
For the blessing of all who hunger and thirst, for all who are weary and heavy laden, and for all who are without house or income, that they seek the restoration the Lord's good hand provides. Let us pray to the Lord.
Bless us, Jesus,
for all who willingly put themselves in the path of evil for the sake of other people's good, including military members, law enforcement officers, and emergency workers, that they be protected by the Lord's mighty hand. Let us pray to the Lord.
Bless us, Jesus, as we are protected by you.
For all who ail in heart, mind, and body, especially those that we have on our prayer list, and those we lift up in our hearts before you now. That they be touched by the healing hand of our Savior and filled with the presence of his comforting spirit. Let us pray to the Lord.
Bless us, Jesus,
for these and all other concerns we have, that coming before the throne of grace we find, let us pray to the Lord.
Bless us, Jesus, and we trust you to hear and answer our prayers. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, for the rescuing work of your Son, Jesus Christ, who overcame evil by the goodness of his death and resurrection. Abiding in his goodness and love, we take up our cross and follow our Savior, receiving from him the blessings of forgiveness. Therefore, with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, we long to magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, died for us all. With gratitude in our hearts, we praise you, O Father. with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is a new testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Amen. Lord Jesus.
O Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, in giving us your body and blood to eat and to drink, you lead us to remember and confess your holy cross and passion, your blessed death, your rest in the tomb, your resurrection from the dead, your ascension into heaven, and your coming for the final judgment. So remember us in your kingdom, and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us with this gracious gift of your Son's body and blood. Now that we have received his goodness of his word and spirit, help us to take some power from us daily and call our Savior, who leads us with the only love that overcomes evil with good. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Receive the Lord's blessing. Do not be overcome by evil,
but overcome evil with good.
Go forth with the blessing of your good and gracious God. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace.
Amen.
Amen. We sing up close again. Follow the direction of the ushers. God bless us. Remain with you today and always.